Thank you so much for coming, guys. As we know, China's grappling with this coronavirus outbreak that has infected more than 63,000 people. What is it like to watch this crisis from far?
Well, for me, it is very upsetting and disturbing to read the news every day on the social media back in China, seeing so many people suffering, and especially when you see so many people that has the virus but cannot be treated and even just die in their homes.
It's hard because I'm from Wuhan, the center of the epidemic. Even though I don't know anyone in the news, it feels very personal because there can be someone who can connect me with a person who's dying there.
I think when the outbreak was beginning in China, I didn't feel that kind of pressure, anger, and all those emotional sentiments. After I went back to the US, and that was actually the time for me personally, I felt the world's eyes on China.
Wuhan, obviously the epicenter of the epidemic right now. It's a city of 11 million people and it's now in lockdown. Why was this the right or wrong decision to make for the city and for Hubei province?
I feel for all the people who are locked in the city right now. They cannot go out to buy the supplies they need. If they need to go to medical facilities, it's hard for them to even go there because the transportation is completely shut down. I do feel like that's kind of a dilemma here. Like, you want to contain this range of the outbreak, but then also you don't want to make the people locked down in the city suffer.
And I think when the government announced the quarantine, it didn't really prepare for all the backup solutions that it needed. For example, there were people who had to go out because they have other illness that couldn't be treated in Wuhan, and that had nothing to do with coronavirus. So we've seen like pregnant women or people with other diseases that couldn't be treated.
The infection rate was initially quite slow, and then it went from dozens to thousands to tens of thousands. Why do you think the government hesitated to publicly acknowledge the outbreak?
I feel like the government was kind of gambling that if we are able to control the disease before it got too big, it won't be international news. It won't attract the attention of the whole nation.
And then obviously something changed.
They lost the gamble.
Well, I think partly it's about this miscalculation from the government, but partly it's also about this very incentive structure of Chinese system, where I think these local officials, they are actually more accountable to their superiors. So the first thing they do when they heard about the virus is to report to their superiors, and for them, like, stability is the first priority.
I think there were huge gaps and discrepancies between different levels of governments in different regions when they dealt with this same outbreak. So when the Zhejiang government labeled this coronavirus outbreak as level one public health emergency, that time the Hubei province still labeled it level two. That's very surprising and ironic for me.
I do see a lot of opinions that's blaming the local government in Hubei and in Wuhan. I think, of course, those officials should be held accountable. But we also see that the mayor of Wuhan said publicly on state television that he did not have the authority to tell the public when the coronavirus was first found. After the last 5-7 years of power centralization in China, we should have expected more mobilization power coming from the government, which was supposed to be the strength of the Chinese system. But unfortunately, I think this time that failed to materialize.
So the Chinese government has been both praised for certain things and also criticized for other things. What's your take on both sides of how they've handled this outbreak?
We Chinese tend to say, oh, it is the community, the government, the whole like collective of individuals, regardless of where they are from, what they are doing, that made the Chinese miracle taken place. But now in this coronavirus outbreak, I actually see an emergence of praise on individual level.
When the system become too centralized, like in China in the past few years, there will actually be a kind of lack of accountability, because then when all the powers are concentrated, for example, in the central government or in a small group of people, the pace of response is going to be very slow because you have to go through all the bureaucracies in between. Of course, this Chinese system has its strengths in this crisis, but it's also the very system that have started this crisis in the first place.
Is there anything that could have been done differently to avoid this crisis altogether?
Well, it's been almost 20 years since the SARS outbreak, and I'm sure there's plenty technological advancement and in our medical infrastructure, in our medical expertise. But the reason why there's even more death and more infections than the SARS this time, of course, there's the nature of the virus itself. But also, I think it's due to like the backtrack of civil societies and also public discourse in the Chinese society in the last few years. When you do not have enough media check and balances on the government, that's when you have the tragedies of, for example, the Dr. Li Wenliang. When you have a media where it could have checked on the government to publish the news, I think a lot of tragedies could have been avoided.
So you also mentioned the whistleblower doctor's death. It's quite rare to see such a united public outcry and even calls for freedom of speech. Can you explain why this has touched a nerve with so many people?
This is the first time they learned that actually, if someone's freedom of speech is blocked by the government, it actually impacts my life too. Because people like him could not alert the public, the whole situation got so big. I feel like that's a realization moment for people to know how important actually it is to have freedom of speech in the society.
It was my first time seeing the definition of whistleblowing appearing in the context of Chinese media. Sadly, because of his death, people start to pay attention on this concept. So for Li Wenliang, this case, I think a lot of audiences were not sure if that was rumors, misinformation, or disinformation. It's all mixed up in Chinese context. It's all one thing. And as long as you are your words falling into one of these categories, you got shut up. I think it is a awakening moment for people to grow their media literacy and how they make a better judgment about different news, different sources, and different primary and secondary information.
Is this also like a nationwide awareness now that people are more aware of how freedom of speech ties in with being a whistleblower, which ties in with protecting your country and like your countrymen?
I've seen some American media or international media citing the hashtag I want freedom of speech on Weibo as a sign that people are really awakening. But I'm gonna be pessimistic here. The people on Weibo and the people who are like retweeting stuff is not a majority of Chinese people. They're pretty much the young people who are have enough resources to be online. And probably the more liberal heart of all these young people.
I think it's kind of exaggeration to say there's a national awareness on freedom of speech now. People are just frustrated and angry about this very incident. They blame the local government. They might blame the police who have arrested Dr. Li. I do not see like a call for reform of the political system in the near future, but I do think at least it's a starting point where people start to realize that some of these civil liberties are also important.
So how do you think the coronavirus outbreak will change China?
I do hope this will be an opportunity for the local and national media to develop, especially investigative journalism. Because we have seen some fantastic reporting this time. Because people have been benefiting from this reporting this time, they will be respecting the journalists more.
Yes, I do think there will be changes on the micro level. Maybe improvements in the healthcare system, the national emergency response measures. But I do think like on the national level, the state will still try to picture it as a, like a national victory after this. So I just hope that when one day, which I hope will come soon, when the dust unsettles, when the crisis ends, people will also remember all the individuals that have lost their lives and have sacrificed so much, all the doctors, nurses.
I do hope that all those sufferings, angers, could become a collective memory for our generation. That could foster a more open and more mutual understandings between different stakeholders.